pray. Almighty God, you are the source of every blessing. Thanks for the gift of life, opportunity to have house of prayer. We pray for the guidance of your Holy Spirit in this act of worship, that we may participate with true devotion and attention, and that by the prayers offered and the praises rendered, for Christ's sake, amen. Hymn 321, 331. Sisters in Christ, And welcome to the celebration of this Holy Eucharist on today, the 11th Sunday after Pentecost. Here at St. George, we conclude our season of emancipation today with our observance of the Day of Remembrance of the Transatlantic Slave Trade and its abolition, which really falls on Tuesday, the 23rd. We welcome all those who are joining with us online, and we pray that this service may truly be an inspiration to us all. Our Mass continues with the opening sentence. Out of the depths have I called you, O Lord. Lord, hear my prayer and hearken to the cry of my supplication. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia. Blessed Lord and Father, Almighty God,
you our hearts are open, all the prayers known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Thank the thoughts of our hearts and the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may worthy of you, and worthy to magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Glory to God in the highest.
And peace be to you,
Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, you are the ruler of all nations upon the earth. We thank you that you are no respecter of persons and have made of one blood all nations of people. Graciously send the light of your gospel upon all nations that sit in darkness, that all may rejoice in the freedom of the light of your presence. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. We now say together the prayer for protection against natural disasters. Almighty and everlasting God, Lord of heaven and earth, grant unto us, your suppliant people, protection against hurricane, earthquake, and other calamities, that in tranquility of weather we may rejoice in the comfort we ever desire, and may always make right use of your bountiful goodness. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Kindly sit for the ministry of the word.
A reading from the word of God written in the book of the prophet Isaiah, the 58th chapter, beginning at the 6th verse. Is not this the fast that I choose? To loose the bonds of injustice? To undo the tongues of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them, and not to hide yourself from your own kin? Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, Here I am. If you remove the yoke from among you, the pointing of the finger, the speaking of evil, if you offer your food to the hungry and satisfy the needs of the afflicted, then your light shall rise in the darkness, and your gloom shall be like the noonday. This is the word of the Lord.
Psalm 67.
From the word of God, written in the letter of Paul to the Philippians, the second chapter, beginning at the first verse. If then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord, and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interest, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Gradual hymn 334.
Thank you.
with you.
And also with you.
The continuation of the Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Mark, the 7th chapter, beginning to read at the 24th verse. At that time, Jesus set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know he was there. Yet he could not escape notice. But a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile of Syrophoenician origin. She begged him to cast out the demon out of her daughter. He said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." But she answered him, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." So she went home, found the child lying on the bed, and the demon gone. This is the Gospel of Christ. Almighty God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Kindly sit, please. Some words from the book of the prophet Isaiah, the 58th chapter, the 6th verse. "Is not this the fast that I choose? To loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke? Is not this the fast that I choose? To loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, to break every yoke." Today, as I mentioned earlier, we come to the end of our season of emancipation here at St. George, where we focus our attention on the Day of Remembrance of the transatlantic slave trade and its abolition. I believe that on moments like this, it gives us an opportunity just to sit for a while and imagine what it must have been like for the ancestors of the people of this region and the Americas. As Equiano Eliado said, one day he and his sister were playing in their yard, and a man just jumped the fence and grabbed two of them, and they were taken away from their parents, never to see them again, never to see their home again. And then they were carried through the jungle for several weeks, and then he and his sister were separated, never to see each other again, and then placed on ships and brought to what was then known as the New World. That must have been a familiar story, a common experience for many. One can imagine the fear, the anxiety, the desperation. One can imagine even worse when they got to these lands to realize the treatment that will be meted out to them. Because let us not fool ourselves. The trade of slaves throughout the world was a common thing. The transatlantic slave trade was not the only trade going on at the time. In fact, millions and millions of Africans were traded throughout the world. But what made this one memorable was not only the treacherous nature of the journey, but the way the people were treated when they got to these lands. How they were seen as less than human. How they were made to work, as I have mentioned several times before. And so today is an opportunity for us just to think back. To think back of what those people would have experienced, but also recognize the providence of God in ensuring that we are here. The mere fact that we are here is a sign of God's presence in our lives because of the harrowing experiences of the past. And therefore, we must always acknowledge this God. We must never let our eyes turn away from Him. We must always put our hands to the plow to do His will, to ensure that our children and their children understand that their very existence is only through the providence of God. That God was here, watching over us all the time, through those dark years of the transatlantic slave trade and slavery in these lands. But I would wish for us to reflect today on this passage from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Because as I've mentioned several times before, the book of the prophet Isaiah can be divided into three portions. There's first Isaiah, which are the first 39 chapters, which we believe can be attributed to the actual prophet called Isaiah, who lived sometime in the 8th century and began his prophetic work around the year 742 BC. And then there is 2nd Isaiah, which runs from chapters 40 through to 55, which we believe can be ascribed to a scribe in the exilic period, who was speaking about the return of the exiles from Babylon to Jerusalem. And then there's 3rd Isaiah, chapters 56 through to 66, which we believe to have been written by someone in Judah after they had returned from the exile. They had rebuilt their temple, and here is this prophet describing what is happening on the ground. Our passage for today comes from 3rd Isaiah. It's very poignant because I want us to reflect today on the hot topic of reparations and what reparations ought to mean for a people. 3rd Isaiah is prophesying to a community that would have received some form of reparations. What do I mean by that? When Cyrus entered Babylon in the year 538 BC, we're told that according to Cyrus's cylinder, Marduk, the god of Babylon, held his hand and walked him through the streets of Babylon. He didn't have to fight. He didn't have to raise a weapon. He conquered Babylon without a fight. And then he issued an edict. He issued an edict telling all the people who were captured by the Babylonians, go back to your homes and serve your gods. The edict to the people of Israel can be found in Ezra chapter 1, verses 2 to 4, and Ezra 6, verses 3 to 5. I'll just recount the Ezra 6, 3 to 5 portion, because that is the portion I want to focus on. Cyrus said, go back, all you people of Jerusalem, go back to Jerusalem and rebuild your city and rebuild your temple and serve your God there. And make sure you say a prayer for me and my son Cambyses. I will give you back all the vessels that the Babylonians stole. Take them back and place them in your temple. And the cost of the rebuilding will be paid from the royal treasury of Persia. The cost for the rebuilding will be paid from the royal treasury of Persia. Here was a new sovereign extending to these people some form of reparation for the losses that they had incurred under Babylon. Go back and rebuild your temple and we will pay for it. We will make sure that you have a community that is thriving there, a religious community. And one would expect that having returned and received these kinds of benefits, the people would have then served God faithfully. But here we experience in 3rd Isaiah, the prophet is saying the temple has been rebuilt and they're going there to pray and so on, but the prayers are not really the prayers that God wants. Because the justice that is supposed to exist in the society isn't there.
people are still being oppressed. And these are people who were held captive in Babylon, you know. These are the descendants of those who were saying, by the rivers of Babylon we sat and wept when we remembered thee, O Zion. And the people of Babylon are telling us, sing some of the songs that you sang in Zion. And we said, how can we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? They have been given an opportunity to return home. The cost for the rebuilding has been paid from the treasury of Persia. But yet there's injustice and oppression in their community. And not only that, if we had read chapter 57, the prophet is dealing with some of the religious practices that are taking place within their community. Because the people have regressed. They've gone back to child sacrifices. They've gone back to cult prostitution and all the other things that led them into the exile in the first place. The very thing that Ezekiel told them caused them to be there. These are the things that they've picked back up. This is the type of injustice and oppression and lack of respect for God and care for God that is taking place within this community. And so I have highlighted that to make the point for us. I support the call for reparations. In fact, I go even further. I know that some in the academic community do not like to hear this. But I also believe we not only look to Europe, but we need to look to Africa. Because many of us were taken away from the land of our birth, taken away from our patrimony. And now we have to ask ourselves, don't we deserve a portion of what our foreparents should have had? Don't we deserve something from there? Yes, there was slavery in Africa, and many of the persons who were brought across here were already captives from wars and so on in Africa. But the question still remains. As we said last year, we need to transform the middle passage from an abyss of darkness to a ray of hope. And part of that ray of hope has to do not only with how we see our brothers and sisters over there, not only offering the hand of forgiveness, not only offering the hand of brotherhood, but also asking, isn't there something for us there as well? I sat in a meeting with one of the tribal chiefs from Ghana, and he promised, come back, there's land here for you. Come back to your home. Now, I want to encourage us that if we are going to discuss reparations, we do not discuss it as individual countries in this region, but we discuss it as a region. We discuss it as the people whom Black Stalin said made the same trip on the same ship. And therefore, that calls for us to look at our relationships as a Caribbean community and ask ourselves, do we see each other as equal? Because that is what the prophet was asking the community of his time. That's what he was calling for, to break the bonds of injustice, to remove the yoke of oppression, to see each other as equal in the sight of God. Because here are people who were once exiled in Babylon and they've returned now and they've started compartmentalizing themselves, separating themselves one for the other, from the other. And we have to ask ourselves, isn't this taking place in our Caribbean community? Look at how many calypsos have been sung about it. Mighty Gabby in 1985, West Indian politician. You tell Trini he's smarter than Bajan. You tell Bajan he's smarter than Jamaican. You tell Jamaican he live, I forgot the song, but anyway. They're telling each other the different things. I know the colloquial way that we say it, but I don't want to use that in a sermon. I wanted to quote Gabby's bit. Because I know the bit we say about each other. But I wouldn't quote that in a sermon. But the question is, do we see each other as equal? The death of the Federation challenges us to look at our relationships and how we see each other. As Mighty Chalkness also said in 1985, remember that all we have is just seawater and sand. So, Bajans can't be happy turning a blind eye to what is happening in other parts of the region, because it's time that them Barbadians understand. You can't sit back and laugh at Jamaicans, because the day them tourist ship don't come from England, sweet Barbados heading for starvation. And we saw that during COVID, didn't we? That we are dependent upon each other. And if we're going to demand reparations either from Europe or even Africa, we have to do so as one Caribbean people. The buzzword right now within the region, I believe their summit is still going on, is food security. And this is one of the ways I see Africa can be helpful to us. Here in Barbados, that is 166 square miles, we just dedicated a portion of our botanical gardens to Kenya. Isn't it time that the places that our ancestors came from apportion a portion of land to us so that we can secure our food here in this part of the region? That is an area we can move as food security. There is land there. I'm not calling that every nation gets a portion of its own, but that the region comes together. In Nigeria, the kingdom of Bonny used to be one of the key places from which slaves were transported. And one king of Bonny once said, the slave trade is a part of our culture. This is what we do. This is when the Europeans were putting pressure now to abolish the slave trade. They were a part of it. These places have large expanses of land. Isn't this somewhere where our ancestors came from? Can't we seek some form of reparation there? I'm not asking for a lot. I'm just asking for enough to keep our people alive here in this part of the region, so that we can have the space to secure food for our children and their children in this region. But even more so, when we look to Europe, we must do so as a region. We must do so as a united body, because we must demand some compensation for the workload that our ancestors put in this part of the world. The money from which went to build the great nations of Europe. You know, when I first went to England, I was riding on their trains and just looking at their network and so on, I thought to myself, so much of our people's blood, sweat, and tears have gone into these things. And we're down here scrunching to get a bus when the day comes. There need to be some form of compensation for the work of our ancestors as well. And we must demand it. We must demand it, though we may not experience the benefits in our time, but there'll be children after us. There'll be descendants of those same people after us who will need these things for their survival in this part of the world. But in order for us to justify those reparations, because like the community in 3rd Isaiah's time, people can send all the money here to us. They can send trillions of dollars to us. But if we have set up ourselves based on class and separated ourselves where there is no equality within our society, where will that money go? Where will the benefits go? We'll be just like the community of Isaiah's time. And somebody will have to call, this is not the fast that I require. The fast that I require is for us to loose the bonds of injustice, to break the yoke of oppression, to break the yoke that binds our people and set them free. Because even as we come closer home in our little microcosm here in Barbados, as long as our country continues to be separated, either covertly or in some cases overtly, based on class, color, status, where one lives, which school one attended, as long as those continue to be dividing lines in our society, all the reparations, you can pour everything into this country, there'll still be inequity, there'll still be injustice, there'll still be suffering, because that is not the fast that God wants. God wants us to see each other as brothers and sisters, as equal in His sight. And then whatever pours into this country will be distributed in that way, with that spirit. And all will experience the benefits of our foreparents. And so as we observe this day and conclude our season of emancipation, let us pay attention to the relationships on the ground. Because while we justly call for reparations, how will it be distributed? Will there be equity in our society? Will there be equality in our society? Will there be justice in our society? Will people be able to live out their lives in the freedom in the society with which God has called us to live? If the answer to those questions are no, then as Wayne Hayde, the mighty watchman, the Trinidadian Calypsonian said, we ain't arrived as yet. We're far from where we ought to be. And so I encourage us, hear the words. Go home and read this passage from Isaiah 58. It is the same passage that we used on Ash Wednesday. On Ash Wednesday, there are two passages of Old Testament that are set out. The book of Joel chapter 2, where Joel encouraged the people, call an assembly, bring the priests, bring everybody together because all is not right in this community. It's the same message of Isaiah 58. And these are people who, if we want to put it that way, would have received reparations. They had their temple rebuilt, the cost being paid from the treasury of Persia. But yet they could not see it fit to show the justice and equality that God wanted to exist amongst them. Let that not be us. Here in this region, this pandemic has exposed our vulnerability. If we didn't know it before, it has exposed our vulnerability. And all of a sudden, we are now talking about food security because we didn't seem to realize that that was a problem before. Perhaps we didn't realize that if one ship gets stuck in the Suez Canal, the whole world can starve. Perhaps we didn't realize that in spite of all, God continues to provide for us and give us what is necessary for survival here. But like the Egyptians going through the wilderness, though God is providing manna, we long for the flesh pots of Egypt still. This pandemic is telling us that our strength is in our unity as a people in this region. And whatever differences we may have had in the past, remember that we took the same trip on the same ship. Caribbean man is one race, Caribbean man from the same place. Caribbean man took the same trip on the same ship. That is who we are. And so I encourage us to forge closer ties with our brothers and sisters in the region. So when we demand our just deserts, when we demand reparations, and I call not only from Europe, but from the other side as well, from Africa, that we do so as a united people. And when we experience the benefits of these things, the benefits will permeate throughout our society where all can experience. That is what God requires of us. Then we will know that the bonds of injustice have been broken. Then we will know that the yoke of oppression has been broken. Then we will know, as Martin Luther King Jr. said, we are free at last, free at last. Thank God in heaven, we're free at last. Amen. Let us now stand and reaffirm our faith in this Almighty God as we say together the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God.
For the church and for all people according to their needs. Lord, in your love,
hear our prayer.
Bless and inspire all members of the clergy, especially Howard, our Archbishop, Michael, our Bishop, and John and Suzette, our priests. Guide and protect all heads of state and all who bear rule, especially those in this land. Sandra, our president, Mia, the prime minister, all members of parliament, and all persons serving in the Senate.
That our people may be guided and ministry.
Direct those who administer justice and strengthen those who guard and protect the land. Reveal the common good to those in positions of public trust and to decision makers in industry and commerce. Enlighten with your spirit all places of education and learning. Comfort and help all persons who are in any trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Remember our brothers and sisters, especially Canon Ivan Hayward, Reverend Trevor Davis, Reverend Amarela Messiah, and all others who have died in your faith and fear.
Grant them peace and eternal life.
We thank you, Heavenly Father, for the witness of the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, for the holy patriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and all the saints who have been good examples in their several generations. And finally, let us pray for our own needs and those of others. Accept our
prayers and intercessions, Father, according to your wisdom. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. The act of penitence. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In a moment of silence, we bring our personal transgressions before Almighty God. And now together let us confess our sins. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and one another in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone. We are sorry and repent of all our sins. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in your glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. If you're offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that a brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Share that peace with each other.
The offertory hymn 308.
Of the offerings, together we pray. Father, we offer you these gifts which you have given us, this bread, this wine, this money. With them we offer ourselves, our lives, and our work, to become, through your Holy Spirit, a reasonable, holy, and lively sacrifice. As this bread and wine become the body and blood of Christ, so may we and all your people become channels of your love. The same Christ of the Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and a joyful thing, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father Almighty, everlasting God. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, all creation rightly gives you praise. All life, all holiness comes from you, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, whom you sent to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. We therefore bring you these gifts, and we ask you to make them holy by the power of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who offered himself in obedience to your will, the perfect sacrifice for all mankind. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this and eat it. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, for the remembrance of me." When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the death of Christ until he comes again. Father, calling to mind the death your Son endured for our salvation, his glorious resurrection and ascension, his continual intercession for us in heaven, and looking for his coming again in glory, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and life-giving sacrifice. Look with favor on your church's offering, and grant that we who eat and drink these holy gifts may be filled with your Holy Spirit and become one body in Christ and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. May he make us a perpetual offering to you and enable us in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Saint George, and the whole company of heaven to share in the inheritance of your saints. With him and in him and through him, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father Almighty, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honor and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. As our Savior has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Lamb of God,
Lamb of God,
gifts of God for the people of God.
First Communion Hymn, number 525. I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong.
Thank you.
Hymn 549.
Post-communion prayer, together we pray. Eternal God and Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you and all persons in you with gladness and singleness of heart, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Our help is in the name of the Lord. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you, and all those whom you love and pray for, this day and forevermore. Amen.
Very good morning to each and every one of you gathered here this morning and online, and on behalf of our rector, Father Rogers, and our assistant priest, Reverend Suzette, a very warm welcome. We extend a cordial welcome also to all those who are visiting here this morning, and especially I want to welcome Edward Dean Clark from St. James Parish Church. Welcome. Welcome also to the Reverend Angela Phillips and her husband Vincent. And to Mr. Charles Clark, a chorister from St. Ambrose Church. Good morning. Welcome. To all our online viewers, welcome. Condolences. The Reverend Canon Ivan Haywood has passed into God's near presence. We offer sincere condolences to his wife Adelie, son Mark Haywood, and the entire family. Please remember them in your prayers. Rest eternal grant unto him, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon him. May he rest in peace. Amen. The season of emancipation ends on Tuesday, August the 23rd, this coming Tuesday. The Health Guild's monthly walk will take place on Saturday, August the 27th, this Saturday, starting at 5:30 a.m. The route is the car park, Walkers, Lower Workman's, Tate Hill, Thorpe's Cottage, Rose Park, Parish Land, Charles Road Bridge, and back to the car park. A nice cycle. In the Winner's Circle Inc., under the direction of Madam Justice Barbara Cook Aline, in collaboration with the Maria Holder Memorial Trust, is currently hosting its annual free parent webinar series, which began yesterday, August the 20th. Flyers are placed on the doors in the south and west porch, and you can read all about them. However, on Saturday coming at 4 p.m. until 5:15 p.m. or thereabouts, the discussion will be with Madam Justice Barbara Cook Aline and Mr. Steve Williams on you, your child, and social media. Parents will learn about technology, monitoring and protecting children while online, avoiding addiction, and there'll be a very enlightening discussion on the Computer Misuse Act. The following Saturday, September the 3rd, from 4 to 5:15, there'll be a discussion on substance abuse prevention with Mistress Makeda Bourne of the National Council on Substance Abuse. You will be made aware
of current statistics on youth drug use, the warning signs, and how to deal with its occurrence. And there's a meeting ID and a password, which is all on the notice board. Deacon Scabbard Ministry, please be reminded to bring your donations of non-perishable food items next Sunday. Also, next Sunday, August the 28th, is the fourth Sunday in the month, and Evensong will be held here at 6 p.m. The season of creation will run from September the 4th, Creation Sunday, to October the 2nd, the Feast of St. Francis of Assisi. Please bear that in mind. St. George Parish Church presents Cultural Delight, an evening of music on Sunday, September the 25th at 5 p.m. Sunday, September the 25th at 5 p.m. Please save the date. Admission is $20 and tickets are available from the members of the choir. The St. George Parish Youth Council is inviting persons between 15 and 25 years to join the Youth Council. Our youth are the future of the church and our community at large. And we have a responsibility to help them understand that they are an important part of our faith community and help them establish their role in the church and in society. The Youth Council is a means of doing that. So if you are interested or know someone who would benefit in participating, please submit their name and contact information to Deborah Smith or email it stgeorgeparishchurch@hotmail.com. That's easy, stgeorgeparishchurch@hotmail.com. The new daylight devotional booklet for September to December is now available. And before I go into the congratulations corner, I will invite Father Rogers to make two announcements.
Good morning once again, my brothers and sisters in Christ. As is the custom this time of year, I believe, in several places in Barbados, we begin to say farewell to some of our young people. A few weeks ago, we bade farewell to little Sanea Elcock, who is now off to further her studies in Costa Rica. And just last week, he wasn't here, but Joshua Wood went off to study as well, another one of our young people. And today we have with us Joy Brathwaite. Joy is leaving us during the course of this week to go to Canada to further her studies. And so we pray for all of them. And Joy, we wish you every blessing. We know you will do well in school. We want you to have a wonderful time. And also we pray that God will grant you peace and security while you're there. Congratulations. And I think I saw a tear in her dad's eye earlier, but poor guy. He sounded a little scratchy when he was giving the notice, the calling the hymns, didn't he? Yes, he sounded a little. So congratulations to you, Major. We also bid farewell to one of our dedicated members. Today will be the last day for that person in this church. And I want to invite her to the front here. Mrs. Lisa Jessamy Maynard. Today she ends her tenure with us in the capacity as a member of St. George Parish Church. On Wednesday, gone, Mrs. Jessamy Maynard was thrust into the role of leading the service here because I was called out urgently to do some work, and when I finished my meetings and so on, I got all these messages about how great her sermon was, and it was so pointed and everything, and people here are nodding who were there yesterday. Well, probably that was
something of a foreshadowing of what is to come, because I only received a call yesterday to tell me that Mrs. Jessamine Maynard will be with us no more as she goes off to Codrington College on Wednesday to test her vocation for the Holy Order of Priesthood. She would have been interviewed a few weeks ago, and I was giving her some trouble of how bad the interview was, and I don't think she's going to make it. But nonetheless, she has been accepted to Codrington College, and I have no doubt that given the work that she has done here and what I've seen of her here, that she will be an asset to our diocese wherever she goes. I should say that current policy in the diocese is that you never return to your home parish. So if you wanted to be here, probably you should have chosen another church too. But we know that St. George will always be in your heart. Obviously, because of the time frame, we were not able to give you the type of send-off that we would want to, and we will do here at St. George, but you will be back at some point in time in the near future when we will give you a proper St. George send-off. Not because we're glad to get rid of you, but just because we are thankful and grateful for the ministry that you have performed here with us. Lisa would have been head of the bereavement group, and also she would have been head of the Deacon's Cupboard group, and she would have been the driving force behind ensuring that people were fed during the pandemic. We did a lot of work. There's some days during the lockdown when Lisa got a pass and said, I need to get into the office, I need to pack something for someone, and all those kinds of things. And even when the others could not come out, she was there to make sure that people were taken care of, especially during those months of the serious lockdown. So Lisa, thank you very much for your service here at St. George. I know it goes long beyond my time, well, preceded my time here, but I'm sure that we will all be happy when we see the results of your work in the future. Thank you very much.
Do you want to say anything, Lisa?
Good morning, everyone. Just let me say that it's not been a surprise, but a surprise to say that today would be my last. I was told Friday. But however, as I was sitting there, what came to mind? This is the church of my birth. This is the church of my birth. This is St. George, sweet, my dear St. George, the church of my birth. I thank you so much for everything. Your prayerful support, I will definitely need. Thank you.
In our congratulations corner, tomorrow, the 22nd, celebrating their 24th wedding anniversary, Basil and Wendella Tull. And in the birthday corner, celebrating on Tuesday the 23rd, Jessica Rowe, she's usually at the 9:15 service. She's the daughter of Corinne Rowe. On the following day, the 24th, Rudolph Bayer, Mark Brewster, and Tyrese Hurdle. On the 25th, Cedric Graham, Bertram Jordan, Trevor Padmore, and Lionel Weeks, one of our ushers who were normally at the 9:15 service. On the 26th, Barbara Nels, and on the 27th, Via Paris celebrates his birthday. To all others who are celebrating birthdays or anniversaries, congratulations. And from me to you, do have a blessed week until we meet again. Thank you very much.
The recessional hymn, number 554.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.
have a blessed and safe day and week, everyone. Thank you very much.